Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. The United States has been the dominant world power in the Middle East for many decades, but under its current president, Donald Trump, Washington has reviewed its interests and commitments in the context of the administration's declared vision of America First. What does this mean for the region in general and Israel in particular? To analyze this question, we're joined here in the studio by Professor Efraim Inbar, who is the president of the Jerusalem Institute for Strategy and Security. Welcome. I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir Oren, and Professor Zeev Khanin, who is an expert on Russian and Middle Eastern studies at Bar-Ilan and Ariel Universities, and also former Ambassador Yoram Ettinger, who is an expert on Middle East and U.S.-Israel relations. Welcome. Mr. Oren, give us a better understanding on the latest developments pertaining to U.S. policy in the Middle East.
One has to cut it in several ways. Perhaps horizontally as well as vertically. You have, on the one hand, the president and his senior appointees who have been appointed to fulfill his vision. You have the career core of his departments and agencies who are usually more conservative in their views of continuity in government, and they are writing the policy papers, which do not always align with the presidential policy, and you have Congress. This is one way to cut the problem. Another way is to see the major lines of effort of American policy in the Middle East. And these are to counter Iran's malign activities, including ballistic missiles, its work through proxies, as well as a Revolutionary Guards Quds Force, and the support it gives to the Houthis in Yemen, and several other such efforts. You have the American effort against Daesh, which is very close to victory, but it's not there yet. You have Libya, you have Yemen, and you have the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, which is still waiting for the acclaimed or self-acclaimed deal of the century.
Professor Inbar, during the Obama administration, there was a sense in the Middle East that a certain vacuum emerged, which allowed Russia and other actors to re-enter into the Middle East and take part of this chaotic region, which seemed a little bit challenging in later years after Obama left office and President Donald Trump re-entered and took office. Something happened in the Middle East where the Americans were not as welcomed in a lot of forums. Nevertheless, everybody understands that the United States is still the world power and still controls and is capable of making the decisions it wants when it wants, depending also primarily on public opinion in the United States domestic. That's why also lately we see more and more American officials speaking about what are the interests of the United States in, for instance, preserving the security of the state of Israel, which just a couple of weeks ago when Senator Lindsey Graham was here in Israel, he connected between the security of Israel to the security of the national, the homeland of the United States. To what degree do you think that this is actually an ongoing development? Is this progressing?
I think the main story is simple. The United States believes that it is less interested in the Middle East. It is no longer dependent on Middle Eastern oil. It has other challenges elsewhere, primarily China, which is a serious challenge to the United States. And we have to admit that their allies in the Middle East are not always very friendly towards the United States, maybe with the exception of Israel, who has been constantly a reliable ally to the United States. So they are entitled, of course, to question what's in it for us. And I think that the question of President Obama, as well as President Trump, is that let's get out of here and cut our losses. I think they their policy has not only been continuous. I think, for example, fighting Daesh was a big mistake because it's anti-Iranian force, and they wasted effort. And of course, relying on regimes like Saudi Arabia to lead the region is very problematic.
Nevertheless, norms and values in the West demanded a battle against Daesh, which might counterfeit when it comes to strategy and security, but sometimes the lesser of two evils needs to be done. Ambassador Ettinger, you've been a longtime diplomat in the United States. To what degree do you think this shift is here to stay, or will the United States once again seek to reemerge as the dominating power in the Middle East?
Well, reality has been highly unpredictable in recent years, mostly in the Middle East, but also in the United States. However, at this stage, U.S. national security policy is shaped mostly by Secretary of State Mike Pompeo and National Security Advisor John Bolton. This approach towards the Middle East recognizes reality rather than dominated by oversimplification and wishful thinking as it was under a previous president, two-term Obama. Under this approach, one of the conclusions has been that while there is less and less dependency on Middle Eastern oil, however, when it comes to the threat of Islamic terrorism, it is increasingly becoming a homeland security in the USA, and it makes much more sense to fight Islamic terrorism in their own trenches rather than wait for them in the U.S. Homeland. In that respect, and many other aspects of U.S. economy, U.S. national security, Israel has gained, has been enhanced as a reliable, unique ally of the U.S. One example is the Golan Heights. It is an American interest for Israel to remain on the Golan Heights. Israel on the Golan Heights is a major, major life insurance agent for the Hashemites in Jordan, presenting posture of deterrence toward Damascus, towards Assad in Syria. If it were not for Israel on the Golan Heights back in 1970, Syria probably would be successful in toppling the Hashemite regime then, with potential ripple effects into Saudi Arabia, Arabian Peninsula. The bottom line is the multipolar world of the Middle East especially, but the world at large, has enhanced the value of Israel to the U.S. national security.
Fazal Khanin, what's your take on this?
Well, I would say that if you are talking about global superpowers, which are three instead of two that we had like maybe 20 years ago, which are United States, China, and Russia, despite of the fact that it's technologically disadvantaged or disadvanced in comparison to the other parties, not only Americans, but Chinese as well at the moment, and despite of the fact that its economic development is problematic at the moment and the demographic and so on and so forth, but it's still a great nuclear superpower. So if we'll take all these points into account, we understand that now the combination is much more complicated than it used to be in the time of the Cold War. The second point is, if I can read correctly their foreign policy map of the Russian Federation at the moment, they could take into account in concern of their relations with the United States, not only their special relations with China, and China at the moment, as we know, is trying to balance between two and to keep their own interests, both in Russia, especially the far east of Russia, the Siberia and the far east, and there are also Middle Eastern interests and interest in Asia. So from this point of view, Russians take into account in concern of Americans another two points besides China. One, that in fact, Americans bought the idea of Mr. Putin that the world, that as we saw it at the end of the Cold War and after the destruction of the Soviet Union, doesn't exist anymore. If I remember correctly, the Bush, the junior, was the first to dissolve the anti-missile defense treaty. Then, now, we see the situation when Americans are ready to finish the whole story of the medium-range missiles agreement. And in Russia, believe that when in 2021 the agreement of the strategic arms limitations between the United States and Russia will complete. Both sides will not be interested to continue that. From this point of view, in Moscow, they believe that they can rearrange the world. Europe is talking about autonomy from the foreign policy, American foreign policy. Here in the Middle East, Americans already, as Ambassador Ettinger told, are ready to pull out as much as possible to transfer their activities to their allies like Israel, which can gain from that, and other parties here in the Middle East. So Russia has the possibility and the place to involve here and or to penetrate here, following their own interests.
Mr. Oren, it seems like the Middle East is a playground for world powers, and the United States obviously is quite aware of the latest developments in recent years, which have placed it in a dilemma. On the one hand, President Trump wants and aspires to bring all the American troops back home, but at the same time, if he does so, the United States will lose its foothold in the region and will be challenged on all fronts by world powers on different arenas across the globe. To what degree do you think that there is a keen understanding in the State Department, in the White House, with regard to the fact that every action that the United States takes and or makes, it will spiral into different decisions by other countries and will shape the Middle East into a different direction?
There's one point on which Trump and Putin agree historically, that if you have regimes, and they could be evil, but they are in place and they have a functioning country, leave them alone. Don't try to fix them, because you are going to get into a trap. You can't do nation building, and then a withdrawal will be even more costly, which is why Donald Trump opposed at one time the war in Iraq. Then later he made some other statements, but originally he was against the war in Iraq. And there were Israelis, by the way, who said at the time that the United States should deal with Iran rather than with Iraq, much as was mentioned here, Daesh as an alternative to Iran. However, once the United States was there and withdrew in Iraq in 2011, the conditions on the ground worsened. So the Americans are facing a dilemma. Should they leave and then be held accountable for what is happening, or remain with boots on the ground and advisors and pour money down the hole? What is going to happen if they do that? So one should look at their actions and not only at their speeches and statements. And one action that you see is the budget, which President Trump has submitted to Congress. And you see, as was mentioned here, that the main rivals which the United States sees are outside of the Middle East, mostly China and Russia, which are considered near peers, then North Korea, only then Iran, and violent extremist organizations such as Al-Qaeda and Daesh. And if one builds the military machine of the United States to contend with world powers rather than with local actors here, one sees that the trend, the vector, is to get out of the Middle East.
Professor Inbar?
I think that there is a clear positive effect on Israel, the American departure. Not that we want it, but because it happens, of course, some Arab countries that are facing Iran are no longer relying on the United States because they are afraid that the Iranians will be able to push the Iranians also from the Gulf. So Israel benefits from better relations with some important Arab states like Saudi Arabia and Gulf states.
When those Arab states approached the United States and explained this threat and the fact that the United States is a deterring power toward their enemies, does the United States actually refer them to Israel, or how does that work?
I doubt very much if they refer them to Israel. I think the main impulse of President Trump is try to defend yourself by yourself. And this is why the Americans are ready to sell, you know, in great numbers, great and very good quality American weapons to the Saudis and others, also for making money, which is important to the American economy. And the mere fact that the Americans are not making specific assurances, it pushes those countries toward Israel. Mm-hmm. But we have also to understand that the exit of one superpower from the Middle East, it gives Israel much greater freedom of action. And once we are constrained to some extent by American actions, by American interests, now if the Americans are really getting out, Israel will be able to do much more to further its own interests. I think that we may get a carte blanche, you know, to do what is needed in Iran, particularly if the Americans don't want to do it. I think that Israel is doing now in Syria things that maybe we couldn't believe that could be done a few years ago, because the Americans don't have a clear interest in Syria. We have actually a good relations with the Russians, primarily because the Americans are not here. Otherwise, it would be much more difficult for us to conduct a constructive dialogue with the Russians, with the Americans looking from our behind our shoulder.
Ambassador Ettinger, when we're talking about the U.S. policy, clearly you've stated the two people that are in the decision process or the decision making of the United States towards the Middle East, Ambassador Bolton and Secretary Pompeo. But at the same time, it seems like the strategy remains the same, the policy remains the same. It just is a shift of scale from one number of troops in Syria to a smaller number of troops in Syria to specific tactical moves that eventually realize a certain position of the United States that we don't need a big army to defeat our enemies, or we don't need actually a big number of forces on the ground in order to bring about American dominance in the region.
Well, in my mind, there's been a sea change from when you compare the current administration's national security policy, Middle East policy on one hand, and the previous administration, Obama administration, on the other hand. One example is the focus by the Obama administration and most prior administration on the Palestinian issue or the Arab-Israeli conflict, as if it were, which it is not, as if it were the crown jewel of Arab policymakers, as if it were a major cause for Middle East turbulence, as if it were the crux of the Arab-Israeli conflict. All of those assumptions have nothing to do with Middle East reality. They have to do with a very, in my mind, oversimplified view of the Middle East. This administration, again, National Security Advisor Bolton especially, but also Mike Pompeo, based on his congressional record, recognized the fact that the Palestinian issue is a very, very, very minor issue on the agenda of Arab regimes in the Middle East. And what we have seen in recent years, and this is highly recognized by the administration, is the dramatic shift in Saudi Arabia and other Persian Gulf Arab states, as well as Jordan and Egypt, recognizing the fact that not only is the Palestinian issue pretty low on their agenda, but a potential Palestinian state would add fuel, much fuel, not water, to the fire of the Middle East, leveraged by the Iranians, by ISIS, by Russia, by China, possibly by North Korea, if it is a player. And therefore, again, the different attitude towards Israel, and therefore the shift from focusing on the Palestinian issue or the Arab-Israeli conflict, recognizing that the Middle East conflict is anything but the Arab-Israeli conflict or the Palestinian issue.
Professor Khanin?
Well, it would be very intriguing to know, to learn one day, the subject Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Vladimir Putin was talking about during their recent meeting. and whether the message came to Washington and what we see in the course of the recent couple of weeks, or whether it's one of the results or what they were talking about. To explain this, let me tell you a short anecdote. A couple of weeks ago, one of the chief editors of an Israeli Russian language media, quite popular media, complained in his Facebook, on his Facebook page that when Israeli media reported about their discovery of Iranian infrastructure on the Syrian land and declared that actually nobody knew about that, including the regime of Mr. Assad, he said that it was, you know, this information came to Israeli media and to the major Russian media in Russia, but nobody cared to tell it to the Russian media in Israel. So we learned it from their broadcast of Israeli radio. It's interesting why the Tzahal, the Israeli Defense Forces, were hurry to inform, to update the major Russian news agencies and the federal TV channels. Probably that was one of the results of the discussion that Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Vladimir Putin had a couple of weeks, or three weeks ago.
Let me actually ask you, and specifically with regard to the U.S. policy in the Middle East, and in particular with Israel, how does Moscow, the Kremlin, and Vladimir Putin as president view the close relations between Israel and the United States at the time when Russia has keen interests in this region and also is quite challenged at times with Israeli activities, even though there's a coordinated mechanism in Syria, is having a hard time dealing with Israel on the Syrian front?
Well, there is no one Russia position on this point. There is a position of Kremlin, or I would say a couple of positions of Kremlin. I mean, it's position of various towers of Kremlin, you know, various clans that are related to the office of the Russian president. And there is a position of the so-called Smolensky Square, the Russian Foreign Office. The position of Smolensky Square is very clear. Israel is an ally, a strategic ally of the United States, will always be there, and we can agree upon some points with Israelis, but Israelis always will be on the other side.
So it will always be a strategic partnership, not an alliance.
Nothing to talk about. So we can discuss a few specific operative things, but not more than that. Concerning the position of Kremlin, actually, they believe that Israel is their strategic ally, could be, but they have to put up the issue with the Iranians. So in this case, if they will find modus vivendi between these two, that's what we will be probably the major line.
Mr. Ulan?
One goes back to a visit by President Peres late in the year 2012. Actually, this was the very week when Russian defense minister was sacked and Sergei Shoigu was appointed. And Peres had the temerity or the goal to suggest to Putin that he, Peres, mediate between himself and Obama. Peres saw himself as an elder statesman on the global scene, and he will take the two kids, everyone was a kid compared to Peres, he will take the two kids, Putin and Obama, and will ask them to behave nicely towards each other. Obviously, the Russians don't need Israel if they want to talk to Washington. And they have some areas of cooperation and some areas of confrontation.
Well, we're drawing near to the end of the program, so I'd like to give each and every one of you still an opportunity to have a closing statement and a short elaboration on that. Professor Inbar, we'll start with you.
I would like to say a few things about Russia. I think there is, in my view, one position in Russia at the end of the day, and this is Putin. Second, I think that Russians have a good respect for our military force. They don't want to be engaged by Israeli Air Force. And this is why they cooperate with us.
And on U.S. policy in the Middle East, though?
And it's important to understand that only us can really harm and undermine the Assad regime, which is an asset for the Russians. Mm-hmm. And this is the nucleus for the cooperation between us and them. The Americans will go out of Syria. It is not a clear interest of them to stay there. Americans, in contrast to the Russians, are not seen as good allies. They are betraying again the Kurds. Maybe there is good strategic reasons to do so, but what the Middle Eastern people see, that Russia is probably a better ally, a more reliable ally than the United States, and it is, in my view, a great pity that this is a perception.
Ambassador Ettinger?
First and foremost, the reality is that U.S.-Israel relations are deeply, deeply rooted based on values going back to the early pilgrims in the U.S., what is called Judeo-Christian values, on top of which we have in recent years, the last 40, 50 years, a very significant level of synergy in the geostrategic area. When it comes to Russia, the closer they deem U.S.-Israel relations, the more enhanced is their respect towards Israel. The higher respect is a derivative of the posture of deterrence by Israel, and Israel's posture of deterrence is driven in many respects by U.S.-Israel relations.
Professor Khanin?
I believe that in Moscow, as well as in Beijing, in Tehran, and other capitals, they still understand that despite of the American declarations that they are ready to pull out from the region, Washington is the place where people will say the final word.
Indeed. Mr. Oren?
Each successful foreign policy must be based on a solid domestic foundation. And Secretary of State Henry Kissinger used to say after the 1973 war and other such crises that his biggest challenge was to handle U.S. foreign policy even while President Nixon was involved in the Watergate problem. President Trump is not yet in a Nixonian position, but it is very difficult to conduct foreign policy in the Middle East or elsewhere while he is involved in domestic troubles.
Well, that's all the time that we have for today, so I'd like to thank Professor Inbar, Mr. Oren, Professor Khanin, and Ambassador Ettinger for being here today. And I'd like to thank viewers as well, and we will see you next time.
You just watched TV7 Jerusalem Studio. We encourage you to pray for the challenges raised in today's program. If you were blessed by our production, please consider supporting TV7 Israel. The details of our respective bank accounts for donations from Europe and the United States appear on the screen. Your generosity allows us to continue to serve God's calling, to broadcast content that truly matters through TV7 Israel from Jerusalem.